You know, it shouldn't surprise us. We've been talking about, you know, these type of things for a while. And so when you're grounded in the Word, and I think that's the most important thing in times that it just are so confusing and hard to understand, that we stay grounded in the Word, because the Word is a lamp unto our feet. The Word will instruct us and inform us how we should live in this time. And in our scripture this morning, if you take out your Bibles, turn to the book of Matthew, chapter 19. If you need a Bible, there are Bibles under the seats. And we've been just going through the book of Matthew, been doing that for a while now, and we're in Matthew 19. What I find amazing about this is we're prone to look at something going on in the world and think that it's new, and almost like we don't know what to do. It surprises us. It catches us off guard. But, you know, the times that we live in, they are unique, but at the same time, it's the same old thing. It's Satan stirring the pot, looking to cause confusion. And for the church, then, Satan's looking for us as the church body to get away from the main thing. And that's what we're seeing in our text here today. We're going to, the title of the message is Understanding Salvation. And it's from the story of Jesus' encounter with the rich young ruler. Now think about this. As Jesus is encountering this rich young ruler, we've seen Jesus throughout the scriptures have different encounters with all sorts of different types of people. But one thing that was the same and a common thread that we see going through these encounters was he always saw the most important thing was a person coming to a place where they know how to be saved. And so Jesus's his encounters with different people was kingdom-minded, so to speak. And I think that's important for our day and age to understand there's a bigger thing going on. There's a bigger picture going on. To understand the Bible informs us and should be informing us how we live, how we make decisions. We know that in the time of the judges, that when there was no king in Israel, everyone did what they wanted to do, what was right in their own eyes. And that's what we're seeing going on today. It's nothing new, nothing surprising. But it's difficult, it's confusing, and it's hard. But as we open the scripture and allow the scripture to bear light on the situation, what we find is there's really a battle for truth and a battle for our idea about truth. And here's what I mean. So here's really what this battle is about. It's about, is there an authoritative, infinite truth that's absolute and set in stone, or is truth subjected to an individual and an individual's feelings and experiences? So throughout history, we've seen shifts in this exact idea. Whether we come back to what they call it epistemology, an epistemology where we see God as the authority, and then we're able to submit under that ultimate authority of God. Or when that shifts a little bit one way or another, and we think, well, the authority is God, but I'm the authority too. That's what Aristotle, his philosophy brought in, that man was redeemed, but mentally he wasn't fully redeemed in the way that his thinking and what he thought was equal or on par with God. So all throughout history, we've seen this ebb and flow between that. And that's what we're seeing in our culture now. Is God going to be the authority of truth that we will bow down to? Or when everybody has their own idea of truth, we get chaos. And that's what we're seeing now. And that's why it's so confusing. So in our scripture, as a body of Christ, understand this. We as a body of Christ see the ultimate authority of God as absolute truth. We bow down to that. We live our life in accordance to that. But that's not even a thing across the board in the church now. So now the church, in many cases, is struggling with that very idea about, is the word of God authoritative and is it sufficient enough? Or is it partially sufficient and authoritative? So now because it's partially, now we inject ourselves in that. And so now across the board as a church, it's not really one body because it's not one body under the ultimate authority. So throughout history, we've seen whenever the authority is not absolute and infinite above man, when it comes down into a finite or human realm, and maybe just some people see it as 100% human, or maybe it's 50-50 human and God, or whatever. Whenever things are going to fall apart, because all throughout history we've seen if our idea of truth has any bit of importance or subjection to man, we're finite and it'll always crumble. So I say all this because in our scripture we see this thread of Jesus. His mindset, his idea is what we should look at in our own lives and say, you know what? As a believer in Christ, this is my mission. This is what I'm about. And it has to be about the gospel. Whenever we lower that into a less than gospel or kingdom-minded orientation, we are going to be confused, and then there's going to be division all over the place. But the unity of church in the book of Acts, we see that they're all in the upper room. Do you remember what it said? In one accord. So that means there is unity. How can a body of Christ, how can a group of people, how can a church with all different people from all different places and all different ages and all different thoughts and philosophies, how can a church be one? Because we submit to a higher authority, and that's Jesus Christ. And as we do that, then we live our life to glorify and please Him. And when we do that collectively now, we are fulfilling that statement that John made, that by your love for one another, then that's how they'll know you're my disciples. But that can only happen when we have an epistemology, a way of thinking about knowledge and truth that's higher than all of ourselves. And so we can collectively come together and say, you know, it's not about me, it's about Jesus Christ. And it's about glorifying Him. When we get off from that, we're going to have what we see going on in our world. When we come back to that, we're going to have unity in Christ. And that's what I love about the scripture. But watch this. In Matthew chapter 19, starting in verse 16, we're going to look at this interaction that Jesus has with a particular gentleman. In verse 16 of Matthew 19, he says, "Now behold, one came and said to him, 'Good teacher, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life?'" So are we prepared for somebody to come to us and say, "Hey, what do I need to do to be saved?" You know what you would tell them? You don't have to say it out loud, but think about that. Are you prepared for that? Are you prepared for maybe some of the potential objections they may have, for some of the questions that are going on in this world that somebody who's not saved or born again doesn't have an understanding of the kingdom mindset? They don't have an understanding, but they see what's going on in this world. And church, we need to understand the fields are white and ready for the harvest, right? When I see all this chaos in the world, I see people that need Jesus. I see a white mission field. I see God allowing things to be stirred up so men would come to the end of themselves and come and recognize their need for God. Because the Bible says that we have to be poor in spirit for us to recognize and realize our need for God. Generally, that's not what we see in our world, in our country. We don't see poor in spirit. And naturally, as human beings, we're not like that. So not only do we need to see and understand the importance of being poor in spirit, but just how being broken and brokenness and seeing brokenness leads us to an awareness that there must be something more. There must be something different. This can't be it. I don't know if any of you are thinking that, you know, this world is, man, this is, it's got to be really good. This is it. This is where I'm putting all my energy and time. This is my home. And when we have that mindset, the world has never been great after the fall and never will be great until Jesus comes back and rules and reigns on the earth. So we're in a fallen world with fallen people, and God has redeemed us through His Son, Jesus Christ. But look at what's going on. So we have somebody, this is in the first three Gospels, this account, and we have somebody that is desperate to know how he could have eternal life. This is someone who is desperate because he's seeing something in Jesus that he doesn't have. And the other gospels say he is running to Jesus. And I find that so amazing that it was the way that Jesus lived his life on earth with a kingdom mindset that made people hunger and thirst for something more. Who is this person hungering and thirsting for something more? This was a rich, young ruler. In other words, this was somebody who in this world had everything and yet had nothing. And this rich young ruler having everything caused him to have an idea and an understanding about salvation that didn't fulfill him, that didn't satisfy him. And so we get this picture that he's almost desperate and he knows Jesus is the answer. So the first thing we have to ask ourselves, and my first point is, this question that he asks is the most important question of life. There's a lot of people today asking a lot of questions. And they may ask you a lot of questions. I want to encourage you to look at this scripture and see how Jesus handles this particular question. But for you personally, what if somebody, what if people come up to you and say, hey, how do I have eternal life? How do I have salvation? Would you know what to say? Would you know how to handle that? In our text, it seems like if we're following Jesus' example, It's a little more than just saying you need to accept Christ, which is true. But I want you to notice that's not what Jesus does. Why is that? It's because this rich young ruler has some things particular about him that are keeping him from Christ, and Jesus is dealing with those things. So a good thing to think about, if someone asks you, how can I be saved? Hopefully you know the gospel, because you can't be saved if you don't know the gospel. But as you share the gospel, understand that everybody we encounter, they have certain things that are keeping them from Christ. Certain things that may need to be dealt with, may need to be asked about, may need to be cleared up, because we see a lot of people having some sort of experience with Christ, right? You have people in your life where there's really no fruit or no direction towards Christ, but they'd say somewhere, sometime they walked an aisle down, they were baptized when they're a little kid or something like that, and they have some kind of, they went to church or a friend, they prayed the thing, and so a lot of people have that. But do all of those people really have salvation? The Bible says no. The Bible says that there's the visible church. You know what that is? That's what we see. But the Bible says there's an invisible church. That's what God sees. So that means that not everybody that goes to church is the church. That means that everybody that says they're a Christian is what? Not a Christian. And this is what Jesus is doing here. But notice his questioning revealed his error. His questioning of Jesus revealed his error. And if we engage people with the gospel, which we should, I shouldn't even say if, as we engage people with the gospel, we should be listening to these little hints and these little clues that people give us. The first one was, he says, good teacher. So he comes to Jesus. He recognizes something eternal in Jesus. That's why he says, what must I do to have eternal life? And remember, that's not just a duration, it's a quality. He was noticing something supernatural in Jesus. He was noticing something divine, something not human. And he recognized that as one who is a religious leader, a rich young ruler. It's referring to him being a religious leader. So with the background of the Pharisees, who had this external legalistic work-based righteousness that led to pride and self-righteousness that you'd think, man, I'm really good. That's what he thought. But get this, he still noticed a divine quality in Jesus. And I believe that's the Holy Spirit shining through us. That's us when we live by faith in Christ and the Holy Spirit's working through us. There's a divine quality that we possess. So we're walking in the Spirit and not in the flesh. And that's why right now it's so important that we don't get pulled in the flesh, because what that does is it negates our light in this world and really what God wants us to do as the church and bring people to the light. So he says, good teacher. Now what he's doing is he's denying the deity of Christ. That's his first mistake. He just sees Christ as somebody who's doing good stuff. He really puts him down on a human level, nothing more. So he wants advice. He wants coaching. He wants a pep talk. He wants something to make him better in this world. You get that? He wants something to make him better in this world. And then he says this, so he doesn't have the right understanding of Christ. So that's the biggest mistake everybody makes, is they don't recognize Jesus is the Messiah, the Christ, the Creator, the one and only one that can save us, that died and rose again from the dead. This separates him from anybody else that's ever lived, ever proclaimed salvation. So he says it, but then he says, this wrong identification of Jesus. And then he says, what must I do to have eternal life? So two things he does wrong. He doesn't recognize Jesus as the Savior. And then he tries to have what Jesus has, that eternal quality, by doing things himself. So this is good. So just from that small statement, Jesus is able to deal with him and not just say, so what if Jesus just said, accept me as your Savior? Or Romans Road, which they didn't have at that time because after Jesus, the book of Romans came. But you know what I mean. See, what I want to just really emphasize before we move on, take a little more time with people. Right? Talk to people. Understand where they're coming from so you can deal with the real issues that they're having. The reason I say that is because we want to be careful of just some superficial profession of Christ. And we want to make sure it's a person who really understands the gospel, really understands what's involved, and doesn't have this superficial profession of Christ. That's what Jesus is doing. So watch what he does. Look in verse 17. So now notice Jesus doesn't just answer him really quick. He says, so Jesus said to him, why do you call me good? Starting to flush out his philosophy. He says, why do you call me good? No one is good but one, and that is God. So the first thing that Jesus is doing in his answer is getting him to understand there's only one that's good, and that's God. Jesus is doing that, from what I see, for two reasons. One, Jesus is doing that because he's bringing him to a place where he sees that Jesus is God. And then two, he's bringing him to a place to see that he's not really good like he thinks he is. Have you ever talked to anybody that thinks they can go to heaven because they're good? Probably almost everybody, in some way, shapes, or form, thinks they're a good person, right? So Jesus is dealing with this, and he says, why do you call me good? There's only one that's good. Only God is good. So here's theology being put out there, and here's what's really important to understand. Only one is good, right? So we have to understand now, that means that we are not good. Did you know that? If only one is good and that's God, that means we're not good. So if we're going to understand salvation properly, you have to understand that I'm not good. We have to understand that our heart is deceitfully wicked above all things. We have to understand that you are dead in your trespasses of sins. Now, if we just start to understand that, we're making some serious progress, right? If we understand that only God's good, that means I'm not good. Now I got problems, don't I? But here's what we do. We start to think, well, I'm good enough. But he just said only God is good. That doesn't leave any room for us to think I'm kind of good. That doesn't leave any room for me to have any thought or idea of any inherent goodness in and of myself. Completely wipes that off the table. So can we all agree and come to a place where we say, I'm not good. But God is good. I'm not good, God good. He's the only one that is good. So he starts off like that, but watch what he says. He says, but if you want to enter into life, and he's referring to eternal life, this quality of divinity, he says, keep the commandments. Now that might have tripped you up when you're reading this on your own, somebody, you're reading your Bible, and he's saying, only God's good, but if you want to be good, keep the commandments. Then you're like, okay, well, what does that mean? So get this, watch this logic. Jesus is saying only God is good, and the commandments are the requirements of good. The commandments, that's the display or the measure of good, the Ten Commandments, the measure of good. So only God is good. The commandments, which he's talking about here, are the standard for good. You're not good, so now you being not good and God good, try to be good by the commandments. You follow that? So God being good, you not good, God the only one good, now try to be good by the commandments. In other words, he's saying, see what happens. See how good you are. That's what the commandments are for, to really shine a light on the fact that we're not good. So in Matthew chapter 5, verse 48, it says, we shall be perfect just as your Father in heaven is perfect. So that's the standard. Jesus is laying out the standard. Okay, you want to have eternal life? be perfectly good. That's what he's saying. But in his mind, he was good enough. And so Jesus is completely dismantling his understanding. So the second point then is what are the requirements? This is what's so important. So he asked the most important question, and Jesus is telling him, now this is the requirements if you want to go to heaven. Be perfect. The requirements are perfection. What do you mean perfection? Perfection is in Romans, it says the righteous requirements. That means that the way we know that we're not good is by the morality, the morals that we think about, immoral or moral, and that we do. That's what Jesus was doing in the Sermon on the Mount. Showing that any sort of not good, any thought of not good, all that does is show us that we can't do it on our own. Because the standard is perfection. Why is it perfection? Why are there requirements that we have to be perfect? Is because God's perfect. God is holy. He's the standard. And so often we make the mistake of thinking another person's our standard. And so we think, well, generally I do more better stuff than the other person does. Generally, I help people with their tires when they have a flat on the side, so I'm a good person. We think those things, you know. But here, this is so important because I think this hits at the crux of the issue with most people we're going to deal with, is to understand the total depravity of man. Since the fall, that there's no way that we can measure up to the standard. And that's what Jesus is bringing out to him. But he doesn't quite get it yet. Look what he says in verse 18. So now he says to him, which ones? So you see what he's starting? He's already starting to compartmentalize. Because probably, well, what we see next is, he's thinking that I've done a lot of good stuff. And he's a religious person, so he knows about the law. He lives according to the law. He teaches people the law and how to do good things. So in his thinking now, he wants to know, okay, which ones? Are there certain ones that are more important than other ones? And Jesus says this, you shall not murder. And he's probably going, check. You shall not commit adultery, check. You shall not steal, check. You shall not bear false witness, check. Honor your father and your mother, check. And then, so that's the second table of the Ten Commandments, which all deal with our relationship with other human beings. The first table deals with our relationship with God. Why didn't Jesus talk about the first table at all? Well, because he's trying to show him something very particular about his sin that he doesn't see that has an effect of the way he relates and deals with other people demonstrates the way he relates with God. But get this last part. This is not part of that set of commandments. He says, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. So now he's saying, if you really want to be good, you have to have this attitude towards other people that I have. And you have to love others. So it's easy to check boxes, those first five, right? But then you think, well, I have to basically see other people, love them like I love myself. So what Jesus is doing is he's showing him through the law that he's not perfect and he's not good. So what is he doing? What is the law? Why is this important for you and I? You have to get this. In Galatians chapter 3, verse 24, it says, therefore, the law, meaning the first thing we think about is the Ten Commandments. And then law was interpreted into over 300 nuances of the law by the Pharisees and scribes. And then get this. Jesus, in the beginning of Matthew, he says, it's not just the outward performance and outward of not doing or doing. It's even if you think about it. You haven't committed adultery? Well, have you thought about another person with lust? You haven't committed murder? Well, have you hated somebody? Have you been angry? Have you, in your heart, called them raka? What does that mean? I don't know. Nobody knows what that means, but something bad. Have you done that? And so he would start to understand, I definitely don't love my neighbors as myself. And now, as Galatians tells us, the law is a tutor to bring us to Christ. Why is that? When we understand our lack of goodness based on what? Do you see why truth is so important, absolute truth? Do you see what's going on in our world? If you ask most people, they would almost all sides, you can have complete opposite sides, and they would say that what I'm doing is justified and right. How could that be? How can you have two opposite views be right? That's when we become the authority. Jesus was trying to move him to a different, a higher absolute authority, and he was doing that through the law, showing him his own sin. So the law, the standards, the Ten Commandments, is a tutor to bring us to Christ that we may be justified by faith, Galatians says. What does that mean? So as we see we're not good, it brings us to a point where we know there's a good that's outside of us, a source that's outside of us. And see, Jesus is bringing this to a place where he's getting him to understand that Jesus is that. And then how do we bridge that gap between the perfection of Christ and the imperfection of man? Romans 3. So those two verses, you need to have those down. Romans 3:20 and Galatians 3:24 and 25. Romans 3:20 says this. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, no flesh will be justified in his sight. Justified means that we're declared innocent. For by the law is knowledge of sin. So think about this for a second. If there was no Ten Commandments, no law, no authority, no standard above us, how would we ever know what's right? That's what we see going on. So watch the nuance. Watch the how we can apply this to our day and time now. Because this is exactly what's going on. There's no higher authority for truth, so everyone's doing what's right in their own eyes. That's why you can't come into any consensus. You can't come to any answers. You can't come to any conclusions because everybody's just doing what they think is right. And we now live in a culture which over the past, I don't know, at least 80, 90 years has brought about a change in our thinking about what is right and wrong based more on man and less on God. We're seeing the fruit of that now. So now people can justify this is right. People on the opposite end, this is right. Who could ever say it's not right? If you don't have a higher authority to appeal to, who can ever say something is not right? You see the dilemma? That's what's going on right now. But see how Jesus deals with this. Jesus, he takes him into a deeper level, a more important level. He's dealing with his heart and not the superficial issues. And he does that by the law. He does that showing him the standard so that he can see he doesn't meet the standard. So how does that work practically for us? Just in our conversations with people, we can't just all the time, there's different scenarios and situations, but we can't say, hey, how can I have eternal life except Jesus without them knowing that they're a sinner? And the reason they need Christ is because they're dead in their trespasses of sins, that their sins are condemning them and they can't do anything about their sin. And the way we can do that is to say, hey, you know, we're all sinners. It happened in the Garden of Eden. And the way you know that is because if you've ever thought hatred in your heart towards another person, if you ever thought a lustful thought, if you ever coveted, you wanted something that somebody else had, if you ever lied to somebody, those are all things that tell you you're a sinner. So what do we do with that? So we have to be able to use the law to show a person how salvation works and why they desperately need to be saved. But look at verse 20. So this is the answer back. He says in verse 20, he says, the young man said to him, all these things I have kept from my youth. He's self-righteous, isn't he? He's looking at himself as, I've done a lot of good things. He couldn't even conceive in his mind that he did something bad. He probably was a very moral person to be able to say that, right? Could any of you say that? I've kept everything. You know, I kept God's rules and laws, everything. I was perfect in my keeping of those. Like, he must have really, this was important to him, right? This was something he probably dedicated his life to being good. And so he thought he was good. But remember what Jesus said in the beginning, only God is good. And Jesus is using the law to show him he's not good. But he doesn't get it yet. And so Jesus gives him that table of the commandments, the second table. And he's thinking about it. And he's saying, and I don't know what he did with love your neighbor as yourself, but for some reason, they're able to think, oh, I do that. Maybe change somebody's chariot tire on the side of the road or something. It made him feel good. I don't know. I'm loving my neighbor as myself. If I had my chariot went over, I have all my people to help me, and now I'm doing that, so I'm good. He's not broken, right? All before this, you remember, Jesus was saying, if you're going to come to me, you must come like what? A little child. A little child. So get this. All these things I kept from my youth, but get this. What do I still lack? Man, the burden of good works, the burden of trying to please God, the burden of trying to measure up, the burden of every day waking up, not knowing if you've done enough to please God, with your eternity hanging in the balance, and just assuming, well, I'm a good person and I've done enough. But what we find here is there is something inside of us that is not met, that is not satisfied. And this is the burden that we still carry of the weight of our sin, even though we're doing good things. Why was he feeling a lack when he was rich and young, and a ruler, and extremely moral? Why was he feeling a lack? Why did he have the need to run to Jesus? Is because all of his life and all that he'd done and all that he had still didn't give him the eternal quality. It gave him worldly things, earthly things. But those things can never give us the eternal things that he saw in Jesus. And he knew it. And he knew, I did all this stuff, but I'm not like you. I don't have that eternal quality. And when Jesus is saying eternal life, what he's speaking of is when we're born again, we have the ability now, because we're born of the Spirit, to relate to spiritual things, to connect with God in the Spirit, to have a whole other dimension of our life that's in the Spirit and not in the flesh. And he didn't have that, and he knew it. Jesus is bringing him to the end of himself. Imagine if he said, good teacher, what can I do to have eternal life? And Jesus said, accept me as your Savior. He said, okay, see you later. That's what we do. That's what we do. But Jesus took his time. And he's bringing him to the end of himself. And he says, what do I still lack? So in Romans 3, verse 10, it says, there are none righteous, no, not one. And this is the futile attempt of you and I to try to be good in and of ourselves to please God and be accepted by God. In James 2:10 it says, "For whoever shall keep the whole law and yet stumble at one point, he's guilty of the whole law." And get this. Galatians 3:10, "For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them." That's why he is feeling the void. That's why he is feeling the burden. Is because he came up to a certain point. For example, the children of Israel coming through the wilderness to the edge of the promised land. And Moses leading them out, Moses representing the law. Did Moses go into the promised land? He didn't go in. He died on Mount Nebo right before the promised land. Why? Well, he represented the law. Who took him in? I forgot. Can you guys help me out? Joshua. What does that mean? That means that's Jesus' name was from Joshua, the Lord saves. So the law can just bring us up. The law shows us. It takes us to a certain point. It says, this is as far as you can go, buddy. You can't go in. You can't have eternal life. In this world, you've accomplished a lot. You've did a lot. And you're a good person and do a lot, but you're not saved. You can't go in. Why? Because you need a Joshua. You need a Savior. And you need one that's perfect. You need one that's beyond you. And that's why our whole faith rests in what Jesus has done and not what we do. So let me read Galatians 3:10 one more time. It says, "For as many are of the works of the law, they are under the curse." He was still under the curse. "For it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them." So he couldn't continue in them. He couldn't perfect them. So watch this. Look at verse 23. So Jesus says to him, and this is where it all comes down. This is where the mind-blowing revelation, understanding of his true condition comes. Jesus said to him, "So you want to be perfect?" So it's this emphasis on perfection. "Go and sell what you have and give it to the poor. Remember to love others as yourself." It's a good practical way to love others as yourself, right? If he was rich, he was loving himself with all his goods and all his riches. So Jesus is saying, well, you want to love others like you love yourself? Well, then go sell all your stuff and give to the poor. And then he says, "And you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me." What was Jesus doing there? And this is what we see a lot of times. If we don't take time with people, we see this. We see people with a superficial acceptance of Jesus as an insurance policy, without a true conversion of the heart that brings about the fruit of the Spirit in one's life, that changes the direction of one's life, where Jesus gives them a new heart and a new spirit, where they hunger and thirst for righteousness. And when that happens, that person is really a different person. But what Jesus is saying is, we have to be willing to surrender whatever it is, whatever's keeping us back, in order to have a relationship with God. So he wasn't setting a mandate, like, you to be saved, be poor, sell all your stuff. He wasn't saying that. But in this particular instance, he was showing the rich young ruler what's most important, and the biggest thing that kept him from following Jesus was he didn't want to give up his stuff. And watch what happens. In verse 22, "But when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful." So it was all fun and games until it really got to the heart and cost him something. So how many people today are running around with an idea of salvation that's not based in the Bible, not based on conversion, not based on being born again, not based on having a new heart. And then they're just going to church every week and the church is never telling them these things. That's what's going on today. The church is never breaking these things out. The church is never preaching repentance and repentance of sin and the need for God because of our sinful condition. When the church stops doing that, what you have is you have all these people running around that say, are saying they're Christian. And I can't distinguish the difference. That's not my job. But I can see in the scripture that it says there are many who say, Lord, Lord, that God doesn't know. And so that's what we see in our culture today. And why is that? Because the Bible is not central in the church. Because the Word of God is not being taught. And when people get all of their theology and understanding from God through social media and through by just relating to events in the world and not connecting them to the theology of God and the biblical understanding of God, we have what the Bible says it would be like in the last days. Where good would be called evil and evil would be called good. Where anybody who professes Christ and actually follows him the way the Bible prescribes will be seen as bad and evil. And we live in that time. But Jesus didn't care about that because he wasn't of this world and he cared about salvation of souls. He cared about the eternal destiny of people. So you see what he is focusing on? So he heard him and then he took his ideas and his thoughts about himself and the world and he brought those thoughts and ideas back to the Word of God and then he pressed the Word of God to his own heart personally. And he got to a point where he said, I don't want that. You had me here, you know, for a little bit. I was interested, but I don't want to give up my stuff. I don't want to lose anything. I don't want to surrender. So what this was the barrier. So think about that when you're talking to people. Everybody has some sort of barrier probably. And it's good to talk about that. Some sort of barrier that they're holding on to. For a lot of us, you know, if you're saved, I'm sure you look back and I can remember, you know, my life when I first gave my life to Christ, I don't want to give up my dreams and hopes and goals and aspirations. I still have my plan. God pretty much stripped all those things away and I'm glad he did. But see, we have to come to God and recognize he's God and I'm not. I'm broken, sinful, and fallen, and he's not. And so I fall under his authority, and I say, Lord, whatever you want, I'll follow you. And isn't that what the disciples did? The disciples left all and followed him. So ask yourself the question, are you willing to do that? What's hanging you up? And maybe you are a Christian, but you're not moving forward. Maybe there's a barrier in your life that's keeping you from moving forward. And I want to tell you that barrier probably has something to do with yourself that you're not letting go of. You're stuck because you won't let go of something that involves yourself. And God's trying to break us all of the addiction to ourselves. You know that we're all addicted to ourselves. We all love ourselves. And the cross breaks that attachment, frees us from the addiction to self, and moves us into submission under God, allowing him to work in us and through us, and that's a glorious life. But this man, he didn't get there. In verse 23, it says, Jesus said to his disciples, assuredly, I say to you, it's hard for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of heaven. And again, I say to you, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. The Bible doesn't have a lot of good things to say about being rich. The Bible has a different view on being rich than we do. So if you've ever been caught up in the prosperity gospel and they're telling you God wants you to be rich, there's nothing wrong in and of itself of being rich. But make sure it doesn't keep you from the kingdom of heaven. He actually is saying it's harder when you're rich to know God. So in another way to look at it, he's saying it's better not to be rich. How many people just want to be rich and you think, well, if I come to church, God will make me rich? People think that. But he's saying it's better. Why? Because there are things that keep us away from God. There are barriers. And God will dismantle those barriers so we can come to the place of knowing him personally. So what does he say next? Look at verse 25. Then his disciples heard this, and they were astonished. Who could even be saved then, they're saying. And here's where this whole thing comes to an exclamation point. And I love the disciples, because they're following Jesus, and they keep getting to these points, they're like, what is going on? You remember Peter said, you're saying these things, and everybody's leaving, these are hard things you're saying. And isn't that interesting that the things that Jesus says and the things we say are different? The Isaiah 55 tells us that his thoughts are not our thoughts. His ways are not our ways. So if that be true, how much do we fight against God that's trying to get us to conform to his ways when we want to keep to our ways? But here's the thing, and they made a good point. It is impossible to be saved. It is impossible to be saved by ourselves. We cannot do one thing to save ourselves. But look at this. We'll finish with this. So this is the answer. So this is where this all goes. He says, Jesus looked at them and said to them, with men, this is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. He's completely referring to salvation, right? If you ever use that verse to think that you could be a pro basketball player or football player and throw that in with Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ. And don't get disappointed because it didn't work out. The whole point is God is saying the only way you can be saved is through me and to have my righteousness. Remember what he said? Only God is good. He brought that all to a head. So here's the thing. As we finish this morning, think about this. Are you ready for people to ask you, how can I be saved? How can I have eternal life? You know what happens at this point a lot of times? Two things. We can get like all fired up, which is good. But another thing is we can be so intimidated and say, I don't know how to explain things really good. And I don't, you know, what if they ask me a question I don't understand? I want to really encourage you because this is really important. As believers, knowing and understanding the heart and will of God through his scriptures is our whole life. That's where we should be investing our whole life, because other people's eternal life depends on that. And that doesn't mean any of us have to be scholars or theologians. Thank God there are people that do that, right? But here's the thing. We have to occupy our main interest is the Word of God. And the Bible calls us to be able to use the Word of God like a master swordsman. Being able to appropriately apply the Word of God to different situations. And here's the great thing. We're not alone in that endeavor because we have the Holy Spirit who will illuminate these truths to us. So what if we're going to get in the game of the Great Commission to make disciples of all the people, if that's going to be why we're on earth, if that's going to be the reason we live, which as believers it should, then our main interest, our energies, our mental engagement should be in the study of the Word of God, so that when we do get in these conversations, that the Word of God, the Holy Spirit will bring to light the Word of God on the situation. And you know what happens when that happens? We start getting really excited about our faith. And so can we as a church, as we finish here, as we pray, can we take a step of faith today and recognize in the times that we live in that we are the church, we're called to be light, we're called to the Great Commission, and we're called to bear the truth on our generation through the Word of God until Jesus comes back. Can we do that? Let's pray. Father, I want to thank you for your word today and just the opportunity to look and understand salvation, Lord. And Lord, you, in your early church, you raised up a few people that were broken and came to the end of themselves, that you filled with the Holy Spirit and empowered to change the world. And you're doing that right here, right now, in our day and age. And we want to say, Lord, here we are, send us. And I want to pray for those here right now and ask for anybody here, if you would say in your heart that you want and ask the Lord to use you to be a light bearer, to be a salt shaker, to be one that God uses in your generation. Guys, the church the world needs the church. The world needs light. So if you will say that in your heart right now and ask the Lord to give you opportunities to share the truth that lies within you, the hope that lies within you, that those people seeking for real answers, the people that are hurting, that are broken, that have put their hopes in this world and are finding out that it's empty. I believe the Lord is coming back soon, but at the same time, I believe that there are many that will come to repentance in the very last days, and God wants to use us for that. So if you would say in your heart, if you say, Lord, use me. Lord, I present myself to you as a holy, living sacrifice. Lord, here I am. You're the potter, I'm the clay. Fill this vessel with the Holy Spirit and use me. Open up doors for me. If you say that, I want to pray for you. Lord Jesus, I pray for those now who are saying, Lord, help me. Lord, let me use my life for your kingdom. Lord, I give you my life. Help me now to take, just do the practical things in life, not to be distracted or pulled in different directions, Lord, but help me to bear upon the world the light from heaven. Help me not to get caught up in the things that at the end of the day really don't matter, but help me to get caught up and compelled by the love of Christ. Lord, I pray that you would pour out your Spirit afresh on those who are asking you to use them. And Lord, I pray for anybody who's listening to this, who does not know you, who is now in a position where their very next breath, they don't know if they're even going to have it and where they're going to end up if they don't have that last breath here on earth. Lord, you say hell is real and you come to save us from hell. So I pray for anybody listening that you'd give your life to Jesus Christ, that you'd surrender, that any barrier that is keeping you from Christ, you would surrender that barrier and you just come as a little child and be born again, by putting your faith in Jesus Christ. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.